Yeah, I've begun.
Very good evening to all. Today we have with us V. Balakrishnan, sir. He is a renowned theoretical physicist and academic fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences. He has taught many years at IIT Madras, and we all are aware of his YouTube lectures on classical and quantum physics. Today's talk taken by sir is on the topic In Einstein's Footsteps, Brownian Motion. We are pleased to have you with us, sir, and look forward to this session.
I'm trying to share screen. Let me see whether this works. I'm getting a Zoom demo here. Sorry, this is going to take a little bit of time. I'm sorry, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, sir.
There's a problem here already. I'm trying to share the screen, but it's not the Zoom meeting itself, it says it's not launched yet.
We can't see the screen that you
share. No, I know you can't see the screen because it's still.
Oh, we can see it. We can see it.
It's trying to connect.
It is visible to us. The screen. It is visible to us.
But I don't know where it's gone here. So,
if you just open the PDF file, I think we'll be able to see it because we are able to see your screen.
You're able to do that? Okay. I'm trying to open the PDF file. Should have been opened already. Can you see the PDF file?
Yes, sir, we are able to see it.
This is weird. Can you see it now on full screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And let me see if it scrolls, then I'll just forget about everything else. Yeah. Okay. So this is the title page. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir, we can see it.
Okay, may I start then?
And it is scrolling for us as well. Yes, sir, sure, we can see.
Okay, good evening to all of you, and thank you for coming for this talk. I'm going to speak on the topic In Einstein's Footsteps, Brownian Motion. But before I do that, let me express my profound thanks, my sincere thanks to Pranav Jain and his team at BITS Pilani Goa campus for this kind invitation to address you this evening. I was supposed to give a slightly more general talk than this, but then after thinking about it, I realized that the online medium is not very conducive, as far as I'm concerned, to very general talks, more or less free-flowing talks. It requires a far more strict adherence to some plan or program. And that's the reason I thought about it and then decided to tell you a story of a scientific discovery, which is in some sense a very heroic story. And that's what the topic today is, In Einstein's Footsteps, Brownian Motion. So let me get started with this. Let's go back to what happens when you have breakthroughs in science. There have been a few of such watershed years in our understanding of science, of nature itself. In 1665, 66, in the 2 years, when Cambridge was shut down due to a disease, an epidemic, once again, coincidentally, Isaac Newton, who was then in his early 20s, essentially discovered the system of the world as it was known then. The law of gravitation, the equations of motion, the calculus, and much else besides. So this was truly a watershed year in our understanding of nature. This was repeated once again in the 19th century. In 1859, Charles Darwin published his theory of evolution. He was then 50 years old, but he had actually made his epoch-making, breaking voyage on the HMS Beagle when he was just 22 years old. So once again, an extremely young person essentially came and overturned existing knowledge. And then finally, it was repeated once again, yet once again in the year 1905, called Annus Mirabilis, the miraculous year, when Albert Einstein, who was just 26 years old at the time, published a few seminal papers that absolutely revolutionized our understanding of the physical universe in really significant and major ways in at least three different directions: statistical physics, quantum physics, and relativity. Today, I'm going to focus on aspects of statistical physics because it would take far too long to get into all of these at the same time. Here's a picture of Einstein in 1905. I flash this here to remind us that it's not always the old man with the long, straggly hair, baggy pants that Einstein was. When he was young, he was actually quite dapper, and as you can see, with the tie and so on. 1905, Swiss patent office in Bern. And here's a small short review of the selected papers, seminal papers by Einstein on what's called. This paper has this very long title on the motion required. No mention of that. This paper was received.
Hello, sir. Sir, you are muted. Sir, excuse me, can you hear me?
Wait a minute. I've unmuted the mic now, so you should be able to hear me. But I'm not able to get the PDF.
Sir, if you want, one of us can present the PDF. Pranav can present it if you.
Let me give it another try. I'm sure it's around here, so let me give it another try.
Sure, sir. And if you are having some bandwidth issues, then I guess you can turn off your video. It saves some bandwidth.
I can do that, right? Okay, here we are.
Yes,
can
sir.
You see?
So you can...
Is the slide projected? Can you see it now?
No, I can't see it.
Oh, this is really bad. I'm going to mute my video, okay? Let me see. If I mute my video, the camera goes off, right? So you won't be able to see that. I just don't understand this.
If you want, like one of us can present the slides and we can change it whenever you
want to do that. Want to do that? We can try that. Because this is getting
sure. Yeah, sure, sir. Pranav, do you have the...
Let me give it one more try.
Okay, sir.
It should come in. I should share screen first. There we go. Should work now.
It is shown that was sharing something, but
is this visible?
So your voice is getting cut a bit, and we aren't able to really see what you are sharing on the screen.
Am I audible now? Is it?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Am I audible now? I should be audible and visible.
Yes, sir, you are. You are audible and you are visible too. If you want, one of us can present the talk.
Would you do that? That may be easier. It was working here,
yes,
all the time. It was working perfectly fine, but I'm not sure exactly what happened. It should work now. Let me try it once again. Is the screen shared?
No, I don't think it is shared right now.
Okay, just a second. I'll get it back on.
Yeah, it is shared. It is getting shared
now. Okay.
Yes, sir. It is getting shared.
That's full screen. It should be okay now.
Yes, sir, we are able to see it on full screen.
Okay, let's keep our fingers crossed. Okay. All right. So, may I continue? Is it okay?
Yes, sir, sure.
Okay. So, Einstein in 1905 wrote these two papers on Brownian motion, as I mentioned. And now I need to know how to scroll. Yes. So let me start by describing what Brownian motion actually is. If you have microscopic micron-sized particles, such as crushed pollen grains suspended in a liquid, these particles show erratic, sudden, irregular movements when viewed through an ultramicroscope, as if they were being kicked around in a random fashion by some mysterious entity. This phenomenon was known from the early 19th century, and it was initially thought it was due to some living force or vital force, something biological. And the motion was studied systematically by Robert Brown, the botanist, in 1827-28, after which it became clear that no vital forces were involved and there was a physical explanation for the phenomenon. By the mid-1850s, the motion was believed to be caused either by internal motions in the fluid, some mysterious internal motions, or by collisions with fluid molecules from different directions. Remember that in 1850, the molecular and atomic nature of matter itself was not established firmly, but this was hypothesized. Here's a random motion, a very, very schematic view of what a random motion looks like of a particle. Real Brownian motion is nothing like this. It has very sharp corners and edges, as you'll see, very sharp, very jagged kind of curve. Okay. Now, what was Einstein's contribution? In short, he recognized that the random fluctuating force due to collisions by the molecules of the liquid on these crushed pollen particles could cause such irregular motion. But then he wasn't convinced that the precision of the experimental observations available at that time was good enough to assert that this was actually so. That's the reason why he didn't use the phrase Brownian motion in his first paper. which had this long theory about title about the molecular kinetic theory of heat, etc. But in the text of the paper, he goes on to say, it's possible that the motions to be discussed here, note how cautious he is as a scientist, it's possible that the motions to be discussed here are identical with the so-called Brownian molecular motion. A very cautious approach to the whole thing. Now, it turned out his guess was right, of course. But his aim was actually far more fundamental. He was preoccupied trying to show that if the predictions of the theory could be experimentally verified, then an exact determination of actual atomic sizes becomes possible. In fact, the determination of atomic sizes, very small number indeed, 10 to the minus 15 meters or so, and of Avogadro's number 10 to the plus 23 or so, these were strongly motivating and recurring themes in Einstein's early work on statistical physics. Notice the boldness of this approach. Here's the person saying that you can make experiments on macroscopically visible objects, and yet you can estimate as large a number as Avogadro's number, 10 to the 23, and estimate as small a size as an atomical or molecular size, 10 to the minus 15 meters, well beyond the reach of anything at all, like a telescope or like a microscope or anything like that. Einstein actually came back over and over again to the determination of Avogadro's number, proposing several independent methods to estimate this very fundamental quantity. And one of his motivations, a very lofty one, was to establish beyond all doubt the atomic nature of matter. And that's exactly what he did. Einstein gave a very ingenious analysis of Brownian motion based on physical arguments. And I want to emphasize this, that it was not a purely mathematical argument at all, but a physical argument involving thermodynamic equilibrium, osmotic pressure, and so on. And it showed great mastery of understanding of what fluctuations are like at the microscopic level. Using these, today, as we realize, he carefully sidestepped many errors that could have arisen from what we now recognize as mathematical subtleties in the behavior of random processes. The random processes involved are today called Markov processes, and they were introduced in the theory of probability in 1906 by the Russian mathematician Markov. This was completely independent of Einstein's work. There was no connection between these two at all, these two people at all. And a year before that, Einstein had essentially recognized that Brownian motion was a special kind of Markov process. Today we call it a diffusion process. In fact, the history of science is replete with these simultaneous discoveries of different people of different times, around the same time. For example, even in the case of this diffusion process, in 1900, 5 years before Einstein, Louis Bachelier had actually studied such processes in connection with financial fluctuations, fluctuations of the stock market prices. He was actually doing one of the earliest proponents of what we today call mathematical economics. So there was independent discovery of our realization of the nature of these random processes, the sort of fledgling knowledge of these random processes around that time. Now, Einstein's success lay in the fact that he could identify the distinct timescales in the problem of a micron-sized object being buffeted incessantly and randomly by much smaller molecules. This was a great insight into the way fluctuations play a role in physics itself. This separation of timescales helped him to write down the equation governing the probability distribution of the position of the larger particle, the tack particle or the Brownian particle. And that in one space dimension is the famous diffusion equation, which says that the density or concentration of such particles, or more in the microscopic language, the probability density that you have a particle at the position x at time t, the time derivative of that is some number d, which has physical dimensions of length squared divided by time, called the diffusion coefficient, multiplied by the second derivative of the same probability density with respect to the spatial variable x here. So this is a partial differential equation, well studied since then, of second order in x, but first order in time. And the first order in time suggests that this is actually an irreversible phenomenon, the irreversibility of diffusion. When you see ink, for instance, diffusing in a beaker of water, you know that this instinctively, we know that this is an irreversible process. And it's very unlikely that even if you wait till the end of the universe, that the ink is going to come back together into form of coherent drop once again. Not only did he propose the diffusion equation, but Einstein also gave the fundamental Gaussian solution to this equation. And the solution looks like this. Assuming that the particle starts from the origin on the x-axis at t equal to 0 and moves back and forth on the x-axis in this irregular fashion, then the probability density of finding it at the position x and between x and x plus dx is this density multiplied by dx. And this density is a Gaussian function, e to the minus x squared over 4 dt. Divide, multiplied by this normalization factor, and this is true for any t bigger than 0. The crucial characteristic feature of diffusion is that the average value of the square of the distance traveled in either direction by a Brownian particle in time interval t is proportional to t rather than t squared. I want to emphasize this over and over again. The average position of the particle will be zero because in one dimension it moves as frequently to the right as to the left, and the average remains at zero. But the mean square displacement is not zero, and in fact, got a behavior which is precisely linear in time. Now, if this were moving purposefully in one direction, then the square of the distance traveled in time t would be proportional to the square of the time, because the distance traveled in time t would be proportional to the time, ballistic motion. But here, because of the randomness involved in the motion, the mean square value at time t doesn't increase like t squared, but increases only like t. And the RMS root mean square displacement is proportional to the square root of t. This is the defining characteristic of diffusion, as you see. So here in graphs is what it looks like. The probability density at time t equal to zero is along the red line. It's starting from the origin. So there's zero probability of being anywhere else. And then as time increases, after a little bit of time, the density has a shape like this, a Gaussian shape of this kind, tapers off. A little later, it has a shape like this, like the green curve, because now the width of this curve has increased for time. Even later, it becomes an even flatter Gaussian, till eventually the whole thing becomes completely flat and it dissipates. The area under the curve remains one always, but the ordinate value tends to zero everywhere. So this is what a diffusion profile looks like. And the width of the Gaussian increases like the square root of the time. So, as I said before, Einstein's deep insight was to concentrate on the mean squared displacement based on his separation of time scales, rather than on the instantaneous velocity of the particle as the quantity to be studied and measured. In fact, formally, the velocity of the particle becomes infinite because if delta x squared divided by delta t has a finite limit, delta x over delta t would actually be infinite. So the Brownian particle technically has infinite velocity. Of course, in physical cases, that doesn't happen. There are other inhibiting factors. But the fact is that asymptotically for sufficiently long times, it does turn out that this mean square displacement becomes proportional to the time itself. Modern generalizations of diffusion use the same criterion. If x squared of t, the mean squared, goes like t to the power alpha, if alpha is less than 1, we call the motion subdiffusive. If it's equal to 1, it's diffusive. If it's between 1 and 2, it's superdiffusive. If it's equal to 2, then it's ballistic motion, like uniform velocity. If it's greater than 2, it's accelerated or superballistic motion. And physical examples of all these cases exist. And once again, using a very ingenious argument that combined thermodynamics with dynamics, Einstein showed that this diffusion coefficient, which is a quantity which can be measured in principle, as we'll see, is given by the gas constant R multiplied by the absolute temperature T divided by 6 pi for spherical particles times Avogadro's number times the viscosity of the fluid in which the particles are suspended multiplied by the radius of the particle, the spherical particle. So there is a formula here, which is today called the Einstein-Nernst-Sutherland formula. Again, coincidentally, this formula was also obtained independently by Sutherland in Australia in March 1905. Historical situation here is the first example of what is called a fluctuation-dissipation relationship. Because the dissipation in the fluid is measured by the viscosity, which is sitting here, and the fluctuations are measured by how far the mean squared displacement increases. So once I put in x squared of t is 2 dt and substitute for capital D, x squared of t is 0 numbers. You observe the mean displacement on the left hand side and plot it. Oh, no, the temperature, the absolute temperature, radius of particles, etc. You can estimate Avogadro's number. And these predictions of this prediction of Einstein's theory was checked. Has the screen blanked out once again?
Yes, sir, you have stopped sharing right now.
Really, I just don't understand this at all. This has never happened. Let's play this again. Yeah, I should be back now. Is it? Is it back now?
Not yet.
I don't think.
But I can see complete. Not sharing. Is it sharing?
So if you want, I guess one of us can present.
Yeah. Could you do that? Could you go from page 16 onwards, please?
Sure, sir.
Okay. Meanwhile, let me try once again.
Piyush, if you can go full screen and...
Is the screen visible?
Oh yeah, the screen is visible. If you could go full screen.
Yeah.
Just press F11. Page 16. Okay.
Yeah. So is it okay now? You can see.
Just give me 1 second to mute myself.
Yeah. Sure. Sorry.
Yes, sir. We can see. Let's just can continue.
Can you make it first? Okay. Fine. I got it. Okay, so with this successful explanation of Brownian motion, all resistance to the reality of atoms was essentially over. By that time, people were absolutely convinced that matter was atomic in nature. I should mention here the names of Smoluchowski and Langevin, who actually around the same time developed the subject further and did a great deal to explain what the real issues are in this problem and its generalizations later. Langevin's approach in particular is based on non-equilibrium basis, is the very basis of what we today call non-equilibrium statistical physics and the applications of stochastic or random processes to all physical problems. Next, please. Next screen. Next slide, please. Yeah. Let's try to build a model of Brownian motion in the following you can regard Brownian motion as the limiting case of a random walk in which the step length is completely random in random directions, and the time between the steps becomes vanishingly small. So the simplest random walks are on regular lattices, but we'll try to see what happens if you just do it in space in three dimensions. So the next slide will tell you how this is implemented. And you can see where the factors will turn up. So the next one, please. Yeah. So let me start from some origin and take a step in some arbitrary direction and call the endpoint R1. The vector, the position vector of the step, the endpoint of the step is R1. I take another step in some other direction, and this is what happens next. In the next slide. The next, please. We could go to the next slide, please. Yeah. So the resultant displacement after the n steps looks like this. You have a whole lot of random steps, and at the end you have an R sub n, which is the vector sum of these little displacements here. And the question asked is, what is the mean squared end-to-end distance? How is it distributed for a random set of steps of this kind? This question can actually be answered, and the next slide tells you how. Can you go to the next one, please? Yeah. So I start by saying that the end-to-end vector R sub n, little r sub n, is the vector sum of all these steps here. Therefore, the square of it is just the dot product with itself, which gives you n diagonal terms, I equal to 1 to n of ri squared, plus I not equal to j ri dot rj, the cross terms here. The next slide, please. Yeah. But if each set has constant length l, then ri squared is just l squared. Therefore, the average value of r sub n squared, the mean square end-to-end distance, can you go back, please? Can you go back? Yeah. Is n times l squared plus l squared times the average value of cos theta ij, where theta ij is the angle between vector ri and vector rj, some angle theta ij. But the point is, since rj and ri are completely randomly oriented, for every configuration in which you give me an r sub I, and then you have rj in this direction, there's an equally probable configuration in which r sub j points in the opposite direction, with an angle theta j prime ij prime, which is equal to pi minus theta ij. And the moment that happens, the cosine of cosine of theta ij. So the two cosines cancel each other, and this cross term cancels out completely. It says my internet connection is unstable, so I'm going to mute the video. Yeah, can we go back, please? So that immediately says that the root mean square displacement is proportional to the square root of the number of steps. And if you take steps at regular intervals, it's proportional to the square root of the time. This square root dependence is characteristic, as I've said, of diffusion. The next slide, please. Can we go to the next one? Yeah. Now let's go to a continuum limit of this random walk in which the step sizes go to zero and the time intervals between the step sizes also goes to zero. And we distribute our step sizes according to some random distribution proportional to 1 over L to the 3.8 in this simulation, particular simulation, which is taken from the internet. And this is what the picture looks like after 10,000 steps. The next slide, please. So it's a completely irregular pattern in which the particle is moving along this curve here, intersecting itself over and over again. 100,000 steps, and the next slide shows you what happens then. In the next step, yeah. It gets more dark in the sense that the plane is getting covered more and more systematically. And theoretically, if you do this long enough, the entire plane will be covered. Every point, the neighborhood of every point will be fixed arbitrarily closely. The next slide, please. So some technicalities. Standard Brownian motion of this kind is called a Wiener process in mathematics. And I'm not going to get into the technicality here of these correlation functions here because of this unstable internet. But Brownian motion is therefore something kind of integral of what we call white noise in engineering. It's a non-stationary Gaussian Markov process with a stable stationary increments in technical terms. And the generalized diffusion process is one whose increments not only have this linear process here, Brownian motion, but also have some multiplicative factor g here, depending on the state vector t, the state of variable x, and then a dissipation term or a deterministic term f of x comma t times dt. So this is a mathematical equation here. It's got a special name here, this kind of equation. It's called an Itô differential equation, a stochastic differential equation. And it's been studied over the last 100 years very systematically. The next step, please. The next slide. Yeah. So here are some, in words, some real peculiarities of such a Brownian cake. The sample path of a particle undergoing Brownian motion in a strict mathematical sense is not an ordinary smooth curve at all, as I mentioned earlier. The trajectory is a continuous but extremely jagged curve, and it's what is called a random fractal. The instantaneous velocity is actually unbounded. And recall Einstein's emphasis on the mean square displacement rather than on the instantaneous velocity. Almost all Brownian parts are nowhere differentiable. And it's statistically self-similar. If you took a small portion of that curve, jagged curve, and expanded, magnified it, it would look exactly the same statistically as the original did. The next slide, please. Go to the next one. Yeah. Here's an extremely rough representation of such a curve. It goes back and forth, back and forth. You go back, please. Go back. Yeah, the next slide will tell you some more properties of Brownian motion, and that's important. I think we skipped a slide. Skip this one, please. Go to the next one. And the next one, please. We'll skip this. Yeah, this is important. Yeah. The curve is space filling in the following sense. If the Brownian part motion is restricted to an infinite line or an infinite plane, then every point of this line or plane is sure to be visited infinitely often in an infinite amount of time. And that's why one should say that all roads lead to Rome in one and two dimensions, because return to the origin is a certain event in one and two dimensions, or a sure event. But the mean time between successive visits is formally infinite, because the particle has an infinite amount of space to explore before it gets back here. If the Brownian motion occurs in three-dimensional space, so-called fractal dimension of its trail is 2. And this is no longer guaranteed that the particle will return to its original point here. There's a finite probability that it might not. This remains true for Brownian motion in any spatial dimension d greater than or equal to 2. The next one, please. What happens to a case where you choose steps which can be arbitrarily long? And this is something I want to say in terms of a figure. If you choose a step size distribution whose variance is infinite, whose distribution goes like 1 over L to the 2.2, so the variance is actually divergent. The next slide shows you what happens to such a walk. It looks very different from the Brownian motion that we talked about so far. It looks like this, and I want to spend a few minutes on this curve here. In fact, this is again 10,000 steps. If you took 100,000 steps, it would look like the next slide. Next slide, please. It would look more and more like this. And look at what this graph is like. There are little clusters, and then there is a long step somewhere else, and there's little clusters and long step, little clusters, etc. If you took one of these little clusters and magnified it, then it would look like statistically like the full graph itself. Combinations of long steps with little clusters here. This is the sort of strategy that you might remember animals practice when they're grazing in a herd. A cow, for instance, would grazing in grass, would graze around in short in neighborhood for a long time. And then it would actually walk deliberately to a distant point where it hasn't explored it yet and start grazing there. And this is the same strategy that bacteria use when suspended in a nutrient fluid, when they're inside a nutrient fluid. They go to different places to explore the possibility of acquiring nutrition from those places. This kind of behavior, clustering behavior, is common to many, many physical phenomena, including the curdling of milk, including the galaxy formation from the condensation of hydrogen clouds in space, and so on. So the mathematics of these Levy walks is actually common to a very large number of areas. And again, it's a generalization of Brownian motion. We go to the next slide, please. I wanted to mention a little bit about the Langevin equation for diffusion. And let me say it once again in words. We mentioned that the velocity of a Brownian particle in principle is infinite, which is unphysical. In practice, a pollen particle suspended, a crushed pollen particle suspended in a fluid will always have a finite velocity. It can never become infinite or so. What happens in that case is that the equation of motion for that particle must be written down more carefully. So let's write it down. This is the Langevin model for such an equation. Mass times the acceleration of the particle is equal to the random force that is exerted on this particle due to molecular collisions. And then there is a term here which is all important. It's the friction term. And this is a little bit like the following situation, which I'll describe in words. Suppose we are walking forwards in the forward direction in rain. Then clearly the rain is dropping vertically downwards. More rain particles hit you from the front than the back. So your back doesn't get as wet as the front does. And the faster you move in the rain, the more your front is going to get wet. And that's exactly what this term does. This term is proportional to minus the velocity, instantaneous velocity. It's acting in the direction opposite to the direction of the motion. And it increases as the velocity increases. So this is precisely what viscous damping looks like. And this gamma is some kind of friction coefficient. And this is the simplest possible mathematical model that you can have for a Brownian particle whose velocity is actually taken to be finite. So the random term is still here, but there's a systematic portion of the random term sitting in here. And this is like a feedback, because the randomness in eta causes randomness in V. The randomness in V is reflected back again here in this term. So there is an extra parameter in the problem, which is a friction coefficient. There's also an extra parameter in the strength of this noise here. And it's very clear that the greater the noise amplitude, the greater the damping would also be. And this is encapsulated in this relation. It says the correlation function of this noise is actually proportional to this friction constant times kT times a delta function. This is the example of another example of a fluctuation dissipation relationship. The same fluctuations that cause irregularity in the motion also introduce a little bit of systematics into it by causing dissipation in the motion. That's a very general phenomenon. Next slide, please. Yeah. So I've already said what I have to say about this fluctuation dissipation theorem. But the physical significance is here. The very same random molecular motion collisions that give rise to fluctuations in the velocity of the diffusing particle also make it possible for reaching thermal equilibrium back once again by damping out random excursions very far away from the average values. The next graph will show you, the next slide shows you this schematically. This technical part of it I'm going to skip. Now we can write down an equation for the probability density for the velocity and the position. For the velocity, it's called the Fokker-Planck equation. It looks like this. And in the simpler case of linear damping, it would look like this for this particle. But I'm not going to get into this here. Let me show you in graphs what happens and explain in words what happens. The next one, please. The next one. Yeah, here we are. Could you go back a little bit? So the distribution of the velocity of the particle looks like this. If you start with some initial given velocity V naught, the probability density that it has a velocity V at time t is given by this long looking expression, a formidable looking expression, but it's actually quite simple. It's e to the minus m times a Gaussian in V, but the Gaussian is centered not at zero, but at V naught e to the minus gamma t. And this is the variance here, and it's got a gamma time dependent term here out here. This is called an Onstein-Uhlenbeck distribution. And as t tends to infinity, it tends to the Maxwellian equilibrium distribution, as we'll see in the next slide in terms of pictures. So here we are. I start with a Brownian particle or a Langevin particle with a given initial velocity V naught, so that the velocity probability density is a delta function at the point V naught. A little while later, once dissipation sets in, here's what happens in the next slide. This distribution shifts towards zero, towards the peak, shifts towards zero to the left. and it becomes a Gaussian, which is the Onstein Uhlenbeck distribution. A little while later, still, the next slide shows you what happens. It drifts, shifts a little further. The width of this Gaussian increases in time, and it looks like this now. A little later, asymptotically, as t tends to infinity, it reaches the Maxwellian distribution of velocities, the equilibrium distribution. So this is a full answer to a time-dependent question. Namely, if I choose a tagged particle in the liquid and I measure its initial velocity and I let go of this particle under molecular collisions, how will this particle return to the equilibrium collection of particles whose distribution of velocities is Maxwellian? And this is the answer. This is the precise answer to that question. The next slide, please. Okay. You can ask, how does the velocity lose its memory of its initial value? And it loses it exponentially so, with precisely the same friction constant gamma sitting here. So this is the mean square value of the velocity, kt over n. So if you set t equal to 0 in this formula, it says the average value of the velocity squared is equal to kt over n, which is the same as saying half mv squared is kt. And that's exactly what kt over 2, which is what the equipartition theorem tells you, equipartition of energy. So this is a time-dependent statement telling you how the correlation dies down, how the memory of initial velocity dies down as a function of time. The next slide, please. We should also ask, what does the mean square displacement do, the physical displacement of the particle? We said that it's not Brownian completely. It's got a Langevin characteristic. It's got a velocity correlation time, which is finite. The exact answer turns out to be not 2dt, but turns out to be 2d over gamma times gamma t minus 1 plus e to the minus gamma, where d is again related to the friction constant by this fluctuation dissipation relation here. In graphs, this is what it looks like in the next slide. So as t becomes long and large enough, the graph tends to 2dt, which is the diffusion limit. The slope of this curve asymptotically becomes 2d. But then in initial times, it's got ballistic motion, goes like t squared, and then it goes like t. Okay. So this is the more complete form of the diffusion process. And now let me make a general statement. Next one, please. Yeah. So to sum up, Brownian motion and its generalizations have become a paradigm for random motion itself, with a staggering variety of applications. And I'm going to read this out to show you how staggering this variety of applications is. For instance, in polymer dynamics, colloidal suspensions, neutrons in a nuclear reactor, stock market fluctuations, resistor networks, dynamic friction in star clusters and galaxies, chemical reaction dynamics, the dynamics of sand piles, chromatography, animal herds, swarming behavior of insects, cloud shapes, Monte Carlo techniques in computer simulation, and so on. And this is naming just a few of these applications. So the applications which started off with Brownian motion, the applications of the techniques and the mathematics used, is truly staggering in this case. The next slide tells you a little more about the ramifications. And in words, the ramifications of Brownian motion arise in diverse areas of both mathematics and physics are just as unexpected and astounding as, for instance, the theory of stochastic differential equations, stochastic calculus, have their origins in the early work on Brownian motion and Wiener processes. And on the mathematical physics side and mathematics side, the Gaussian solution written down leads the so-called Wiener measure, generalizations of the heat kernel to arbitrary Riemannian manifolds, to the Feynman-Katz formula, to the path integral formulation of quantum mechanics itself, and then to the modern method of quantization in quantum field theory. So you can see that over the last 100 years, how much progress has occurred in both physics and mathematics, bringing based on this Einstein's initial insight into Brownian motion. The next slide, please. Here's a short bibliography on Einstein in 1905, worth reading, every bit of it. There's a wonderful book by Abraham Pice called Subtle is the Lord, The Science and the Life of Lord of Albert Einstein, published by Oxford University Press in 1982. This deals not only with his with the biography, the life of the man, but also of all the science that he did. And then there's a wonderful collection by Stachel called Einstein's Miraculous Year, Five Papers That Changed the Face of Physics, published in 1998 by Princeton University Press. Well worth a read. And then Rigdon's book, Einstein in 1905, The Standard of Greatness, published by the Harvard University Press, Cambridge in 2005. The next slide, please. Yeah. Now, sitting back, what can we students of physics learn on general grounds from Einstein's revolutionary achievements? What is it that we really, what's the take-home lesson? Well, we learned that it's very, very important to ask questions. No matter how peculiar or silly they may appear to be at first sight, to get to the fundamentals of the subject as clear as possible, get them as clear as possible. And it's very important to acquire a very clear understanding of the basic principles and issues involved. And this was demonstrated by Einstein over and over again in his various papers. We also learned that it's extremely important to appreciate the vast range of physical parameters on which nature acts, on which natural phenomena occur, in contrast to the extremely restricted range in which our everyday macroscopic phenomena occur and our everyday experience lies. And as a consequence, it's necessary to overcome preconceived notions that are not substantiated by facts and to avoid confusing notions such as physical intuition with understanding. So facility in a certain range of physical parameters doesn't mean understanding of that range at all, and conversely. So this is important. And here's the range on which nature acts. Human perception with our bare senses, without mathematics and without instruments, will go from 10 to the minus 4 to 10 to the plus 4 for mass in kilograms. You cannot tell the difference between a microgram and a picogram, but you can tell the difference between a tenth of a gram and 10 grams. And that's what this range tells you here. Nature, on the other hand, operates from the mass of an electron, 10 to the minus 30 grams, 10 to the minus 30 kilograms, to 10 to the 50 or 60, actually, depending on how big the universe is, or even more. As far as length in meters is concerned, human perception is from the breadth of a fine hair, which is 10 to the minus 4 meters, to 10 to the 4 meters, 10 kilometers. Say, on a clear day, you can see up to 10 kilometers. Nature, on the other hand, operates from the Planck length, 10 to the minus 35 meters, all the way to the edge of the universe, 10 to the 26 meters, give or take an order of magnitude. As far as time in seconds is concerned, bare human perception would go from a flicker of an eyelid, a blink of an eyelid, 10 to the minus 1 seconds, to up to 10 to the 7 seconds, maybe a year or so, at best, or a few months, without any other time signals at all. But nature operates all the way from the Planck time, 10 to the minus 42 seconds, to the age of the universe, 10 to the 17 seconds. So this tells you, in a nutshell, the vast canvas on which natural phenomena occur. And this is just mass, length, and time. The same is true for every other physical variable, as compared to what we can perceive directly without analysis, mathematical analysis, and without instruments. With instruments and analysis, we managed to penetrate large sections of the other range in all the three variables here. So this is the reason why certain things like relativity and quantum mechanics look like the previous slide, please. Could you go back? Yeah. This is the reason why certain things like quantum mechanics and relativity look very counterintuitive to us, but they're perfectly natural phenomena. There's nothing counterintuitive about it. It's just that our intuition, quote unquote, which we've developed in order to understand the world in this middle range of physical parameters, cannot be extrapolated blindly without extension to the vast range on which nature operates. That's the reason those subjects look apparently counterintuitive to us, but there's nothing counterintuitive in nature at all. The last slide shows you now a few general lessons, and this is worth remembering. Physics is a relatively old science. In its modern version, it's nearly 400 years old. And much thought has been given to the underlying basic principles and phenomena, and fairly cogent structure has emerged. A picture has emerged which tells us reasonably cogently what is going on at different scales. Therefore, the motivation as students of physics should not be to make a revolutionary discovery or to overthrow Einstein or Newton or any of the icons. That should not be the motive. Nor should it be to get the Nobel Prize or other high awards and prizes. I'm making this philosophical statement here, take it or leave it, because I often hear young people being encouraged, quote unquote, being told, please win a Nobel Prize for us, for our country, and so on. That's not the primary motive which will win a Nobel Prize. what will win a Nobel Prize is something very, very different. It's hard work and a clear understanding of what the issues really are in science. So it's worth remembering that. And very often one finds people working on problems in order to show somebody is wrong, and Newton is wrong, or Einstein was completely wrong, or an overthrow, etc. That's not the motive which would succeed. That's not at all the right approach here. To quote the great physicist Landau, gave this wonderful talk called Plain Talk to Students of Physics. One must never work for the sake of ulterior motives for fame with an aim at making a great discovery. And then he says this very bluntly, nothing will come of it anyway. Whether something comes of it or not, that's not the correct motivation. The ultimate motive should in fact be to understand with honesty the way nature works, and everything else follows from that. Thank you very much for your patience. That's all I have to say this evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. If you want, we can start taking some questions from the audience, if there are any.
Sure.
Actually, I had a question. Okay, yeah, sure.
Bhuvan,
go ahead.
Okay. So first of all, thank you for this wonderful lecture. And thank you for making time out of your schedule to give us this lecture. So I had a question. Are there any studies on Brownian motion with regards to astronomy? So perhaps something like Brownian motion in the asteroid belt or the Kuiper belt or beyond, such motion might happen.
In fact, I should mention that. Thank you for bringing this up. One of the greatest articles in physics ever written, which had an enormous citation statistics, is a wonderful paper by Subramaniam Chandrasekhar, published in the Reviews of Modern Physics, volume 15 in 1943, pages 1 to 89. Since it's such a popular thing, such a standard reference, I know the reference by heart. This paper is titled On Stochastic Processes in Physics and Astronomy. So there are astronomical applications involved here. But a very short answer to the question of whether there is such a concept as friction in dynamical, in astrophysics, the answer is yes. Chandrasekhar, in fact, initiated and developed this concept of what's called dynamical friction. You don't have collisions there, but what you have is the influence of a star in a star cluster. The gravitational force of all the other stars acts on it in a random fashion in some sense. And because of these random gravitational fields, the particle's trajectory, the star's trajectory, is a very chaotic, arbitrary, very irregular one. And it leads to what's called dynamic friction. So there is the analog of this constant gamma that I talked about. And you can ask questions like, what is the distribution of the force, random forces, magnitude of the random force acting on a particle, on one of the stars in this random cluster of stars here? Such questions have precise answers. There's a distribution called the Holtzmark distribution, which gives you the distribution of the magnitude of the force acting on a star in the gravitational field of a random collection of stars. So there are, and then subsequently in plasma physics, there is a huge amount of literature on stochastic processes and their applications. So right from the beginning, there have been very serious applications to astrophysics in a variety of contexts. So one should also remember that most of the universe is in a plasma state, which is not a crystalline state of matter or regular state of matter in that sense, no long-range order in that matter. And therefore, you have plenty of opportunity for using stochastic techniques in the analysis of such problems.
Thank you.
Well, actually, my question was quite similar to Bhuvan's question. I was actually thinking about the dynamic system of the sun. You know, basically all of the magnetohydrodynamics which occurs over there because of all of the interacting plasma and all of the breakage of the magnetic field lines. And yet it sort of results in an orderly system, so to say. So I kind of wanted to ask that, can some form of an orderly system be created with a chaotic from a chaotic system like that of Brownian motion?
Well, yes and no, because there's always some order in chaos, as you know. There are quantities which you can precisely evaluate, like Lyapunov exponents, correlation functions, etc., etc., which are all characterizers of trying to bring some kind of order into the motion, which is random. There are two aspects to it. There is something called deterministic chaos, where the dynamics is completely classical, deterministic, etc., but the motion is chaotic in a very serious technical, in a specific technical sense. The other thing is random noise, the effect of random noise due to the environment, due to other influences which you have incomplete information about, etc. So the question of, given a time series of some fluctuating variable, the question of determining how much of it is due to deterministic but chaotic influence and how much of it is due to stochastic influence is a serious one. And there are deep answers to it. There are very quantitative answers to this problem of trying to separate these two things. But if you look at, in broad terms, if you look at something like turbulence, which is what is happening in these turbulent plasmas, it looks like completely random motion, but there is order in it. There are many, many scaling relations in it. As you know, Kolmogorov is a pioneer in this field. And these are efforts at trying to understand the degree of regularity that's present underlying this apparently totally random problem, random dynamics. So yes, in every kind of stochastic or random dynamics, there are quantifiers which will establish to varying degrees what kind of underlying order you have in this system. I understand it's a very vague answer, but short of getting into the technicalities of Lyapunov exponents is the best I can do at the moment. But yes, there is always order in chaos in some sense, in some.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for that answer. I do kind of understand it. There is a course in our curriculum, at least for us physics students, which deals with nonlinear dynamics, and another course which deals with statistical mechanics. So I'm hoping that those courses might be able to shed some more light on this phenomenon. Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
You should also include, the sources, ultimate sources of fluctuations in normal cases would be twofold, right? There would be thermal fluctuations due to the environment, some finite temperature, and there would be quantum fluctuations which would operate independent of temperature at all temperatures. You cannot switch off quantum fluctuations. And each of them has its own consequences, etc. So the non-zero value of Planck's constant is also a source of fluctuations, like quantum fluctuations.
Okay. So, like, basically on the fundamental level, the universe is random.
Depends on what you mean by random. It's you have to make it much more precise. For instance, one often hears the word quantum mechanics is not deterministic, it's probabilistic, and so on. But the fact is that it gives you a very precise rule for calculating probability distributions. So it's true that the results of experimental measurements could be defined as being drawn out of some sample ensemble or whatever it is, some average values, etc. But the fact is the distributions themselves have a perfectly deterministic evolution, like the Schrodinger equation or the Liouville equation for the density operator.
I was kind of referring to that only. Basically, the uncertainty principle in quantum mechanics and the various probability distributions, which are a result of that. So.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But yeah, on a large scale, we are just our quantum states collapse, our wave functions collapse, and we result in a deterministic system, like our own bodies, for example.
In a sense, first of all, the usual elementary thermodynamics doesn't apply to us because we are open systems, right? We exchange both matter and energy with the environment. We are open systems in that sense. And we are completely out of thermal equilibrium. So equilibrium statistical mechanics doesn't apply either. So, and we are hierarchically organized on several levels. So we are what is today called fashionably a complex system. And there are levels of organization. There's a hierarchy of organization here at various stages. And each level has, it seems to have its own laws, etc. So it's possible they all have one common reductionist origin, ultimately. But the fact is that there are these things called emergent phenomena at every level. And more is different, as was famously said by Anderson. So we have phenomena appearing on various at various stages in collections of objects, each of which collection doesn't have certain properties, but the collection does, and the property emerges as a result of the collection of the interaction between the various entities. So we're getting to know some rules in this business, but not everything. Complex systems is a largely unexplored subject as yet. We don't understand the basic rules in many ways. But we have learned certain things. We've learned, for instance, that short-range interactions can produce long-range order. So that's a very important lesson. We've also learned that very simple rules at the elementary level can produce a very, very complex outcomes in general. So once again, very local, simple rules at a very local level can produce very long range effects on a global level, and very, very significant effects can be produced with short range interactions. So we've learned some of these general lessons now. We've learned how to deal with situations where fluctuations on all length scales and time scales are equally important and they all couple to each other. So we have tools like the renormalization group analysis, etc. We've come to an understanding that quantum field theory itself is best viewed as some kind of effective field theory at a certain level of, at a certain range of, in a certain range of parameters and so on. So there are these very general lessons that we are learning very slowly. We're beginning to learn the meaning of entanglement in the quantum mechanical sense, what its implications are, etc. What role it plays in the equilibration of systems, the attainment of thermal equilibrium by systems. Namely, the fundamental foundations of statistical mechanics are being examined, and we're gaining greater and greater understanding on of the fundamentals, where the postulates come from, etc. So there's steady progress being made on many of these fronts.
Okay, so thank you so much for that answer. There's just one more question from our audience on YouTube. They're asking, sir, as I understand it, movement of fluid particles isn't exactly Brownian since their instantaneous velocity doesn't reach infinity. Is there an example in the universe that is exactly Brownian?
Well, not a real example, not a physical example, right? Physical particles, it's not true. Infinite velocity is not possible. But what you can have is a model for systems like stock market fluctuations, etc., which could arbitrarily closely mimic Brownian motion, or the stochastic process called the Wiener process, which is the mathematical word for Brownian motion. So you could have processes which are modeled very exactly to some very high degree of accuracy by Brownian motion. So this is entirely possible. But of course, in the original example of colloidal particles suspended in a fluid, they are Brownian particles in a certain regime of time, what's called the diffusion regime. They undergo Brownian motion as an approximation in on time scales large compared to the velocity correlation time. So large compared to the gamma inverse of the gamma parameter I introduced. On those time scales, the motion is essentially Brownian motion. So in that sense, it's a physical realization in some range of physical parameters here. So that's possible. But one should look at the numbers here. If you took crushed pollen grains and put it inside a fluid, let's say water at room temperature or something like that, then the velocity correlation time depends on the viscosity of water at that temperature. and it typically will turn plus the size of the particle, etc. And it typically turns out to be of the order of microseconds. On the other hand, if you look at the molecules of water themselves, there's or a fluid or a gas, for instance, in the gas in this room, generally a molecule occurs about has about 10 collisions per picosecond. So 10 to the minus 13 seconds is the time scale on which time between collisions for this particle. Now it interacts by van der Waals forces with other molecules, and the electromagnetic interaction time is of the order of 10 to the minus 15 seconds or less. So you have a hierarchy of time scales. There's the interaction time scale of electromagnetic interactions. Then there is the time between collisions, which is of the order of 10 to the minus 12 seconds or so. And then you have the correlation time of the velocity of large colloidal particles, which is 10 to the minus 6 seconds. So it's this separation. And then you have time scales much larger compared to 10 to the minus 6 seconds, like milliseconds or seconds themselves. So on these time scales, you can analyze the problem by separation of these time scales very clearly. That's what enables the analysis to happen in the first place here at all. So Brownian particles, for instance, would have colloidal particles in a fluid would closely mimic Brownian motion on a certain time scale. But of course, many other phenomena could happen also. You could ask, for instance, taking the gas or particles in this room, suppose I switched off the fans completely and then had still air, so to speak, and I sprayed perfume in one corner of the room, and the other corner of the room is, say, 6 meters away. The question is, how long does it take by molecular diffusion for the perfume molecules to reach the other end? And if you calculate this in the absence of convection currents and so on, it's of the order of a week to a month. Now, that's way too long for perfume manufacturers to wait for the perfume to have any effect. It's very clear that that's too slow. So what's happening is not primarily molecular diffusion, but thermal currents, convection currents, which are carrying the molecules of perfume much faster out to the other end of the room. And the manufacturers of perfume can breathe a sigh of relief at this short time scale. So many phenomena occur, and you have to disentangle them, which becomes possible if you have separation of time and length scales in these problems. Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for that answer.
Sir, I had one more question.
Sure.
You had mentioned about the dynamical friction. So, if I understand it correctly, it acts like friction, but it's not physical, right?
Well, it's physical. It's very much physical. It's there. It's just that it doesn't happen due to hard collision.
It's not a contact force. It's just
it's not a contact force. Yeah.
So does this very dynamical friction? Yeah. So does this dynamical friction also exist in other systems? I mean, in particular, my thought was, are dynamical frictions existing in superfluids maybe? So even if they are non-viscous or no frictionless, then maybe due to this dynamical friction, it can introduce some Brownian motion in them as well.
I don't know. I have to think about this. I don't want to give a hasty answer. I haven't thought about it. I don't know. I don't know the answer right away. One should think a little bit more about this. But one thing is true, that you need, sort of intuitively clear, that you seem to need long range forces, like the gravitational force, for instance. And in matter, whether it happens with van der Waals forces is not very clear to me immediately. I'm not very sure about this at all. But it should be possible to work this out. But I'm sorry, I don't have an answer.
Okay. Yes.
But it's true that one should mention here, since you brought this up, if you look at the actual molecular motion in a fluid, a single molecule, if you tag a molecule by some procedure or the other, you hypothetically tag this molecule and watch it move, that is not what Brownian motion is, because the tagged particle in Brownian motion was a crushed grain of pollen, much, much bigger than the actual molecules of the fluid, much more massive and much bigger in size. A single molecule cannot be modeled very in a fluid, cannot be modeled very successfully using the very simple Langevin equation approach that I talked about here. Because the time scale on which it moves is comparable to the time scale on which fluctuations itself occur. So this simplistic notion of a constant friction is not any longer true. You need a hierarchy of equations, sometimes called the BBJKY hierarchy, in order to understand at molecular level what happens to the molecules of the fluid themselves. At the very least, if you use a Langevin type model, you'd have to use a memory kernel in the problem. You'd have to use what's called frequency-dependent friction and so on, and certain complications will immediately occur this year. So in that sense, this is just the zeroth step in some sense.
Okay, thank you.
If I have your permission, I could give your email to, I could share your email with one and others who might have more questions, and they can email you the questions.
Sure. I don't promise an immediate reply, but certainly eventual reply, yes.
Yeah, sure, sir. Thank you so much. I think Snehashish had something to say.
Yes, sir. Sir, first of all, thank you for the lecture. My question was, when the variance of the step size diverges in the second case, how does that affect the space-filling nature?
That's a very good question. Eventually, yes, now you're asking a question whether in Levy walks, return to the origin is certain or not.
Yes, sir. I believe it is.
I believe it is, but I haven't really worked this out. That's an interesting question. Are these walks recurrent or not? I believe it is, but don't quote me on this. But it's a strong function in any case of the dimensionality, you know, of the space in which the walk occurs. I believe it is. That's my gut reaction. It would be that it is space filling in one and two dimensions, but I'm not willing to swear to this.
So, and one more thing. What would be the physical analogy to the variance of the step size? Like, what can it relate to?
Well, it depends on what you're modeling, right? So that was just a model. The variance was chosen in such a way, the distribution was chosen as a power law in such a way that the variance diverged. That's all numerically, okay. Some exponent here. But you're asking, is there a relation like the diffusion constant, which measures, which is the coefficient of T in the expression for in Brownian motion for the mean square displacement or the variance, if you like. Is there some analog of this D, some coefficient like D, in the behavior of the mean square displacement, asymptotic behavior? And the answer is yes. Yes.
Okay.
There is a coefficient. It will not, in such cases, you don't get a simple equation like the diffusion equation or anything like that. You could get much more complicated. You could get integral differential equations with an integral over the space variable, etc. Then you could also have non-Markov processes where you have memory in the system and you don't have an exponential waiting time distribution between collision, between steps, etc. Then once again, you can have subdiffusive behavior if the waiting time density is sufficiently weighted towards long times, etc. So huge, and those are called continuous time random walks, and the huge literature exists on that. So generalizations of this original Wiener process in that direction are also possible. They've also been studied in great detail.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, I think that was all of the questions that we had. Thank you so much, sir, for...
Welcome. I should interject to apologize for this very flaky connection that I have with the internet connection.
No problem, sir.
Thank you very much for coming to the rescue and actually projecting the slides. I checked out my the projection and the screen sharing and so on at least twice today, and it worked. And the internet connection was very robust, and I thought everything is going to be fine, but apparently not. Because I did check what was happening. Periodically, I was getting a message flashed here saying that your internet connection is unstable. So I was hoping that
we can understand.
I was hoping that instability would not extend to such an extent that it would actually blank everything out. But what was happening was periodically my screen was going blank, especially the projections was going blank completely, and I had to reboot it once again. Although it is, I put the talk on the desktop, so it didn't take too much time, but still it was a nuisance all the time. And thank you for coming to the rescue and taking care of this.
It was our pleasure, sir. And it was really amazing and really interesting to have you here. Thank you so much for taking out the time.
My pleasure.